In the last 4 weeks, I've been speaking about the great issue of truth, and I've fronted with the idea that truth is not fixed and absolute. It's not final and certain. Truth is said to be relative and situational, that is, relative to the individual based on their perception, their scruples, and it's situational based on the circumstance that one may find themselves in at any given time. Excuse me. And of course, I've been pointing out that what all of this evolves into in a society, in a word, is secularism. It's what we call secularism, and I've talked a lot about this because it's truly what we're seeing today in American culture, and it's pervasive. It's like leaven inserted in the lump of dough. It begins to have its influence in everything about that dough. And secularism in our day is pervasive. This is why we're seeing such a great division in the culture today. It isn't Democrat, Republican. That's not the issue. The issue is secularism with its view that truth is relative and situational. Secularism on one hand, and over here are people like us who believe in tradition, who believe that God has spoken, that there is revealed truth from heaven, that there is a sense of right and a sense of wrong that we need to come to terms with. That's the division that's going on, and we're seeing it like no other time in our history, at least as far as I have lived. I believe, personally, this is the greatest danger we're facing as a nation. And that's quite a statement because there's a lot of danger all throughout the world that might create some really serious problems for us as a country. But I believe this is the greatest danger we face. And I say that because of what it ultimately leads to. It leads to utter chaos. It leads to a world that is without a sense of definition, without a sense of right and wrong. It would be like, a world like that would be like getting in your automobile and you're going to drive to the West Coast and the highways are all there, but there are no lines to divide traffic. There are no red lights. There are no stop signs. There are no route numbers. There's nothing to help you understand the journey that you're on. No definition. That's what we're talking about. That's what ultimately evolves in a culture of secularism. But then also what evolves in that world is a lot of very angry and cynical people. Let me define what I mean. Cynicism, these are dictionary definitions, by the way. Pardon me. It's the idea of distrusting or disparaging the motives of others. This is characteristic of the cynic. Showing contempt for accepted standards of honesty or morality by one's actions. How about this? Bitterly or sneeringly distrustful, contemptuous, or pessimistic. Look at this. These are adjectives, expressions of the cynic. Skeptical, mocking, ironic, sneering, pessimistic, scoffing, contemptuous, sarcastic, sardonic, scornful, distrustful, derisive, misanthropic. That means the idea that people are prone to withdraw and try to live their lives alone. People become loners. I like this. By the way, have you seen any of this on the news lately? I like this by George William Rutler. He writes, "Cynicism is an intellectual stance that seeks to debunk the motives of other people and expose commonly treasured ideals," forgot to put the I there, "generally for the sake of making the cynic feel superior to others or freeing him from the necessity of attaining difficult virtues." Isn't that true? The need to feel superior to, or because I don't want to pursue a certain way of life that's virtuous, I will mock it and condemn it. Now, needless to say, what we're reading here is everywhere. Frankly, I have never seen so many angry and cynical people. And the truth is, folks, it's only going to get worse in a culture of secularism. Secularism breeds cynical, angry people. It literally does. The Holy Spirit works in our life, and the product of the Spirit is love, peace, and joy. The fruit of secularism is angry, cynical people. And so here's the question. What does this mean to you and I, to all of us as Christians? What does this mean to us? And I say that because, let's face it, the call of God upon our lives is to reach out to people, to share with them as best we are able the message of the gospel, the finished work. That's why we're here. God doesn't save us and we end up getting baptized and He leaves us here even after we're saved. He does that because He wants to use you and I to reach out to others, to try to awaken them to the message of the loving gospel, the finished work of Jesus Christ. And so as a church and as Christians, how can we have a positive impact on people like this? How can we get them to at least hear the gospel with an open heart for evaluation? How do we do it? Well, the answer is two things. Number one, we have to hold to the truth. We can't compromise truth. The Bible is the inerrant, infallible Word of God. I'm committed to that. Like Martin Luther said, "Here I stand, I can do no other." The Bible speaks to life. The Bible is revealed truth from heaven. I'm committed to it. The Bible teaches us that all life is sacred, whether in the womb or in the latter years of one's life. I'm committed to that. I'm committed to the death. I will not budge when it comes to truth. And all of us need to be the same. We're committed to the word of truth. We're committed to the teaching of truth, that there is life and all of life is sacred. Human life, that is sacred. We are to be committed to that. No compromise. But then at the same time, we have to back that truth up by a lifestyle of holy love. In fact, let me suggest that truth and love are like two wings of a bird, and you need both, don't you? You've seen that little sparrow that maybe injured a wing and it can't fly. It has one good wing, but it can't get off the ground. You need both wings in order to progress, in order to soar. Truth and love. In Ephesians 4:15, Paul calls us to speak the truth in love. Speak the truth, don't compromise, but wait a minute now. How should we convey that message? We do so packaging the message of truth with God's love. I was listening early this morning on my way to church on my car radio, and I heard Ravi Zacharias speaking to a university crowd, rather hostile, but he spoke with such dignity and spoke the truth without compromise. But everyone who heard him, if they were at least open, would sense the love that he had for them. He does it so beautifully, like Jesus, who spoke the truth everywhere he went, but always with love. Warren Wiersbe said this, "Truth without love is brutality. Love without truth is hypocrisy." I get that. It's easy to speak the truth and wipe someone out in the name of truth, and we just kind of leave them lying on the floor. But we were right. On the other hand, it's easy in the name of love to compromise truth. Well, I don't want to make them feel bad, you know. I don't want to offend them. I don't want them to be irritated with me. I don't want them to think that I'm one of those Bible thumpers who goes to that Journey by Grace church, you know. Let me show you this. Truth sounds like hate to those who hate truth. I would argue that this statement is an explanation for these campus riots that we're seeing on the news almost daily now. Truth sounds like hate to those who hate the truth. Now, let me show you what is a very important passage that we all need to see and understand. It's found in the Gospel of John, chapter 17. There's a context to this. John 17 is being recorded as Jesus is praying to the Father. And as he is praying, he realizes that he himself is only hours away from death. And he knows from Scripture in the Old Testament, Psalm 22, Isaiah 53, he knows what kind of death is ahead. And what is on his mind? What would be on your mind if you knew you were going to die in a matter of hours in a brutal, harsh manner? This is what was on the heart and mind of Jesus. Look at verse 20. He says to the Father, "I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message." Now that's us. We believe in Jesus and the gospel because of their message, the apostles. So he's praying for you and I. He's praying for us. And here's his prayer. "I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one, as you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us," look at this now, "so that the world will believe you sent me." The world in the first century, believe me, under Roman rule, was as cynical as it is today. And he's saying, look, this is important because as you live this reality, the world will believe in what you're saying. Look at this. "I have given them the glory you gave me so they may be one as we are one. I am in them and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity," here it is again, "that the world will know that you sent me, and that the love and that you love them as much as you love me. Now, I didn't write that, but what it's saying is true, that Jesus loves, the Father loves you as much as he loves Jesus. I mean, look at it. As much as you love me, that you love them as much as you love me. Boy, the Bible says, Zephaniah 3:17, that our heart is quieted by his love. And that's what that does for me. It quiets my nervous, potentially anguishing of heart. And then in the next verse, Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you loved me even before the world began. Jesus wants you and I to see his glory, tasting it now, but ultimately living in that glory. Oh, righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed them, I have revealed you to them, and I will continue to do so. Then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them. He's looking down the road to Pentecost when the indwelling presence of God became a reality. So again, I've revealed you, Father, to them, and I will continue. Then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them. Now, what I want you to see in this text is that being able to love others comes from, I'm going to suggest, two main things. Number one, it comes by receiving God's love personally through his indwelling presence. That's where it all starts. And then secondly, it comes as we are made aware of the great love that God has for us as individuals. I mean, think about that. The greatest person in all of this universe, the living God, has personal love for you. This is, to me, so powerful, and it can be powerful in all of our lives as we live in the awareness of being loved by God. The Bible says we love him because he first loved us. Exactly. By the way, remember, there is a huge difference in the way that God loves the world of humanity in contrast to the way he loves those who are believers, those who are born again into his family. In other words, does God love the unsaved guy who is living without faith and pursuing a life of rebellion? Does he love that guy and that woman? Absolutely. John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. However, his love for the believer is very different in the sense that he gives to us and offers to us what is called theologically a covenant-based love. It's like a husband and wife. They stand before the altar, and the husband and the wife covenant together in relationship. They say, I do to each other. They covenant together in relationship. Now, when they leave the church, do you think they love other people beside themselves? Absolutely. But the love they have for each other is now very different. It's such a different love between a husband and wife. It's what I call I do love. Let me show you this. The meaning of the I do in marriage. You are actually saying, this is the foundation of the biblical covenant. You are saying to your husband, your wife, all that I am, I give to you. and all that I have I give to you. So the bride and the groom say this, and it's encapsulated in the I do of commitment. But this is also true for you and I as believers. We say to Jesus, Jesus, all that I am, I give to you. And Jesus, all that I have, I give to you. And then Jesus says to you, all that I am, I give to you. And all that I have, I give to you. Yeah, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And this covenant that Christ has with you is sealed by the blood of Jesus, by the blood of the cross. Let me show you this passage in Ephesians 3, 17. This is a prayer of the Apostle Paul, and he is praying that, notice, he's praying for believers now, not for the unsaved, but for Christians. He's saying, I'm praying that your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand or comprehend, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep His love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. May you experience. It's not about learning something out of a book. It's about experience. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste His love. Experience that incredible love of God. Look at this. Ephesians 5, Paul writes, imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered Himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Now, there it is. Live a life filled with love. But did you notice the motive that He gave us? There's a very important motive behind the command, live a life filled with love. And here it is in verse 1. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children. It's not that we're just children. You know, it's not right to say that all of us on the planet are children of God. Jesus talks about some people who are children of the devil, John 8:44. In a creative sense, yes, we're all children of God, but that isn't true in a redemptive sense. The believer is more than a child of God creatively. We are His dear, dear children. This goes back, actually, the word dear child it comes from that Greek word that I've talked about before, agapetos. It's talking about being the object of a very, very special love. And you see, this is really what Christianity is supposed to be all about. Christian faith isn't some religious system that's stale and boring. It isn't about superstition. It isn't a type of personal mysticism whereby we attempt to achieve ecstasies with God. It's this right here. It's this simple. Christianity is a love-based relationship with God that leads to loving other people. End of argument. In fact, look at this. 1 Corinthians 13:13. Paul writes, three things will last forever. faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. And then in the very next verse, which happens to be 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, here's what he says. Let love, agape love, be your highest goal. Now, that's the New Living Translation. It's a little weak for me. The NIV puts it this way, follow the way of love. The New King James puts it, pursue love. The RSV says, make love your aim. In other words, in all of your relationships with people, make love your aim. Make love. You want to lift them. You want to encourage them. You want to be a blessing to them. Now, all of these are very good statements. But let me show you this. The Greek word that's translated follow or pursue comes from the word dioko. Dioko. Dioko means, again, dictionary definition, to run swiftly after in order to catch a person or thing. It means to press on, figuratively of one in a race, who in a race runs swiftly to reach the goal. It means to pursue, even in a hostile manner. Do you remember Popeye? He always got to the place where he said, that's all I can stands because I can't stands no more. And he pops that spinach, and he goes to work. Pursuing is like, I'm gonna make this happen, man. I'm gonna love that person. I'm gonna do it. No matter what, I'm gonna do it. That's what he's talking about. You remember the Hulk? And he would take so much, and then he started to Hulk up. And he went berserk almost, and he took his man down. Stuart Briscoe did some research on this word, and he came up with what I think is the best definition of it. He says, dioko, in this verse, it means to establish as a goal and pursue after relentlessly the goal of agape love. I don't think you can define it any better than that, because that's what we're to do. To establish as a goal the goal of loving people and do it relentlessly. Relentlessly. Now, because I want to live this lifestyle of love, and I do, and I assume that you do too, if you're a Christian, because this is what Christianity is all about. So let me offer you three things this morning in order that we can understand how to make this happen for us. Number one is this. We have to see love as essential. And since it is essential, what that means is we have to decide for it. We must make the choice for it. That means we have to cast aside excuses. And I know about excuses in this area. We say, well, that's just not my personality. Or we might say, well, that's not the way I'm wired. I just don't like to approach people. It's just not me. That's not the way I am. I've heard that again and again. And I understand it. Believe me, I do understand the reluctance. But the issue for Christians, it's not about what I can do and can't do. It's, will I be obedient to what God says? And when we are obedient to what God says, then God supplies us and provides for us all that we will ever need to carry out what he's calling us to do. Romans 5:5 puts it this way. He, meaning God the Father, has given us the Holy Spirit to fill or to flood. I like the word ravish, to ravish our hearts with His agape love. And this happens in response to our obedience. And by the way, I hope you can see that there is a very, what we're talking about here, this is very different from the modern romantic idea of falling in love. People think that you go into a crowded room and you're on one side and she's over there and your eyes meet and boom, skyrockets and you fall in love. Look, that is not the idea behind Christian love. Please understand this. Christian love is a decisive love. It doesn't just happen. You make it happen. You make it happen. That's why you find all through the Bible, Old and New Testament, command after command to love. Imagine me commanding someone to love me. Carmen, love me. It feels awkward and it's not right on a human level. But remember, we're talking about God who's calling us to love one another. And when we choose to obey what He says, He gives us the power to do what we can't do. In fact, if you're like me, and I believe that you are, whenever you see these commands to love the unlovely, to love those who hurt you, to love those who have treated you wrongly, to love people who are your enemies, on and on. If you're like me, you read that and you say, wait a minute, I can't do that. And the truth is, I can't do that, but I can obey God. And when I obey God, He supplies me with what I don't have. You see, we have never been given the power to do, but we do have the power to choose. And what we choose determines what we do. If we choose the flesh, well, the flesh takes over. If you choose the Spirit takes over. And you experience the reality of the work of the Holy Spirit. I remember years ago, I heard the story of a woman by the name of Corrie Ten Boom. I actually heard her speak. She's dead now, but back a number of years ago, in the 70s in particular, Corrie Ten Boom traveled the world telling her story. She was a Dutch lady from a Dutch family, and in the beginning of World War II, her family, being a Christian family, believing that life was sacred, protected Jews. They hid them, did all kinds of things for the Jewish people because of, you know, Hitler and the Nazi Party. They were out to kill all of the Jewish people. Ultimately, that was their goal. So their family, the Ten Boom family, was committed to helping save these people. Well, as it turned out, they were eventually caught. The father was killed. The brother was killed. And Betsy and Corrie, Betsy was Corrie's sister, both of them ended up in Ravensbrück prison camp, which was a prison camp very similar to Auschwitz, where thousands and thousands of people were being executed. Well, in that prison camp, after a period of time, her sister Betsy became sick and sicker and sicker, and eventually she died. And then toward the end of the war, because of a clerical error, Corrie was released. God was certainly involved in that. But she ended up being released. She went back to life, and after the end of the war, she traveled Europe telling her story of how God was with them through all that they went through. She tells the story of being at a meeting one night and having shared her story. I believe it was in Frankfurt, Germany. Don't hold me to that, but I think it was. After the meeting, when she gave her testimony, she was walking down the street with a friend, and this man came up to her, and here's what he said to her. "You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk. I was a guard there. But since that time, I have become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did there, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well, Fräulein." The hand came out. "Will you forgive me?" I stood there, I whose sins had again and again been forgiven and could not forgive. Betsy had died in that place. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? It could have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me it seemed hours as I wrestled with the most difficult thing I had ever had to do. For I had to do it, I knew that. Yet still, I stood there with the coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is not an emotion, I knew that too. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. "Jesus, help me," I prayed silently. "I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling." And so woodenly, mechanically, I thrust out my hand into the one stretched out to me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in my shoulder, raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hands. And then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. "I forgive you, brother," I cried with all my heart. For a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, the former guard and the former prisoner. I had never known God's love so intensely as I did then. But even then, and here's the key, I realized it was not my love. I had tried and did not have the power. It was the power of the Holy Spirit. This was something that to her seemed absolutely impossible. But once she made the decision, God gave her the power to do what she could never do in her own strength. Again, Romans 5, "He has given us the Holy Spirit to flood, to fill, to ravish our hearts with His own love." So that's my first point. Here's my second. Secondly, if we're going to learn to live in holy love, love is not just a means to an end. In other words, we're not just loving people so that we can help them and reach out to them. Love is not just a means to an end, it's the end in itself. Here's what I mean. 1 Timothy 1:5, Paul says, "The purpose of my instruction." Now, Paul taught a lot, right? 13 books in the New Testament. The Holy Spirit used him. What's the purpose of all of that? "The purpose of my instruction is that," help me with that word, "all believers should be filled with love." The purpose of my instruction, the purpose of our teaching, is that all believers would be filled with love that comes from a pure heart, a clear conscience, and a genuine faith. Look at this, Romans 13:8. owe nothing to anyone except for your obligation to love one another. If you love your neighbor, you will fulfill the requirements of God's law. One more. John 15:12. This is my commandment, says Jesus. Love each other in the same way I have loved you. How did Jesus love his followers? By means of the power of the Holy Spirit. He lived in humanity, but he was empowered by the Spirit to do what was beyond human. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. I'm reading these verses because they simply make my point. Love is not just a means to an end, it's the end in and of itself. That's why Paul said in verse 13, 1 Corinthians 13, love is the greatest. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, love. And the greatest of these is love. Now, why does he say that? Well, think about this. Faith is doing something with what God has made available to us. Hope is the expectation of more and more to come. But God never says in Scripture that he is faith. The Bible never says God is faith. The Bible never says God is hope. But the Bible does say God is love. Therefore, to learn how to love is to achieve the ultimate, which is to become like God himself. That's why love is the greatest, and that's why everything we teach is designed to move us more and more toward that goal. And here's my last point, thirdly. When we love as a true Christian, we are making an investment in eternity. For example, Jesus said, a cup of cold water given in my name will never go unrewarded. Jesus talks a lot about all of us understanding and working at laying up treasure in heaven. That's the way he put it. And frankly, that's what we do when we love the people that are in our life. In fact, what we really need to understand, folks, is that success in life from a biblical point of view, from a Christian point of view, it's not about being known or unknown. It's not about having things or money. It's not about being a pastor, a missionary, a priest. It's not about any of those things. It's about whether or not you become an individual who has learned how to live in holy love. That's what matters. Let me show you this. Almost done. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1. If I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it, but if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Now look at this. In verse 4 through 7, he's going to define love. So here's what I want you to do. Every place where you see the word love, or in verse 5, when you see the word it, it's underlined and darkened there. He's talking about love. That's where the idea is. Love is, and then he says in verse 5, it is, meaning love does not demand its own way. So everywhere you see that, put the name Jesus there. And it fits so beautifully. And then put your name there. And you will learn about your walk with God. Love is patient and kind. Jesus is patient and kind. Now put your name there. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. Jesus fits beautifully. But when I put my name there, it's a little rough at times. It does not, that is, love does not demand its own way. Jesus does not demand. Bill does not. Whoa. Love is not irritable. I certainly saw that in Jesus. But my wife isn't here today. She's sick, unfortunately. But she will tell you there have been times when I have been irritable. I haven't been loving. Is this only about me? Love does not demand its own way. Love is not irritable. Love keeps no record of being wronged. Love does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith. Love is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. I think you can see we all have a lot of work to do, don't we? I close with this. In Matthew 5:46, this is the challenge. Jesus said, "For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same?" Tax collectors in the first century were thought to be the scum of the earth because they sold out their heritage and they sold out their nation and they sold out their race. They were thought to be very much like mafioso people. They were exploiting for the sake of greed, and they were hated. And Jesus says, wait a minute, even that group of people love those who love them. And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? That question in darkened words there is what I want to leave hanging over our congregation today. What do you do more than others? What sets you apart from the rest of the world? Well, I don't drink, smoke, chew, blah, blah, blah. All right. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about character, virtue. What do you do more than others? Do you love unlovely people, tough people, difficult people? You say, Bill, I can't do it. I know that. That's why you need a Savior, right? What's He saving us from? He's saving us from our inability to live the life that we are called to live, from our sin, and giving us the power to do what we could never do. I would say this in closing. Remember this. The one who calls you to love loves you as a believer like you can't begin to imagine. You are His dearly, dearly loved agapetos. Let that sense of being aware of His love for you. You are worth a son to God. Let that truth just take over your mind and penetrate your cold emotions and compel you to a life of love for others. Let's pray.